Hey, what's up YouTube? What is going on? This new video, I just wanted to make a quick note on hip mobility and core stability and how it relates to low back pain. Now before I jump into things, I just want to mention that I put up a few new articles on my website. Feel free to check those out. There's a couple articles just around low back pain, and for those of you guys that are currently dealing with low back issues, I'm sure you may find a few of those articles helpful. Anyways, on to this video. So when it comes to hip mobility, and core stability for that matter, and how it relates to low back pain. Let's understand that the trunk is a tower, and it needs to be stable, because if it's not stable, we may deviate to certain positions, and we may stress certain tissues more than we'd like to when we're doing an activity or playing a sport. And as a result, maybe an injury occurs, such as maybe a stress fracture, maybe a herniated disc, or maybe you have some osteoarthrosis maybe developing the facet joints. So if the spine is not stable, then deviations may occur and we can get maybe leaks or just deviations in our system. Now, when it comes to hip mobility on the other hand, if we aren't mobile at our hips, for example, if we lack hip internal rotation or external rotation or maybe hip flexion. So for example, this is hip flexion, just bringing my knee towards my chest, maybe a hip extension, whatever case may be, whatever hip mobility restrictions or issues may exist, what may happen is that when we go to bend over, maybe if we're trying to deadlift, maybe squat, we may compensate up at the lumbar spine and we may go into flexion as a result of these mobility restrictions at our hips. And a good example could be seen with hockey players. And just using myself as an example, I was a former hockey player myself. Many hockey players have terrible hip mobility. And that's just a result of being on the ice all the time and always skating. And then you often will see a lot of these hockey players, they may have a lack of hip internal rotation, also maybe deficits in hip flexion. So hip flexion, just bringing knee towards my chest. And then if we look at internal rotation, just bringing the knee, think about bringing it inwards. There may be a lack of movement at the hips. So as a result of that, if you lack hip mobility and maybe you try to deadlift or you pick up any object off the floor, you may not be able to get in a good spinal position because a result of those hip mobility restrictions, limitations, and you may have to compensate by going into lumbar flexion in order to pick up an object or in order to deadlift. And as a result, this is how an injury occurs. So, with that being said, two very important factors to look at for yourself, or maybe if you're working with somebody that has low back issues, is what is their core stability like, and also what is their hip mobility like? Because the one thing is, the more we move at the lumbar spine, the more likely we're going to injure ourselves. Because when we move, specifically when we move under load, such as flexion or maybe flexion and rotation, and as we increase maybe that compressive load and continuously do cycles over time, that's how an injury occurs. And if we have restrictions at the hips, we may compensate by moving at the lumbar spine more, which is not what we want. And so it would be important to look out and assess those two areas, the hips. What are the hips telling you? Is there any deficits in range of motion? Maybe is there a discrepancy from left to right side? Also, what is the lumbar spine? What's the stability like of that as well? Once you can assess that and identify those factors, you could then look to address any weaknesses or deficits through a proper strength and conditioning program, and you can start to put together the appropriate exercises to perhaps address those hip mobility restrictions and also improve your core stability if you're lacking in that region or that area. A big thing of all this is just getting people to move properly. And if there's restrictions, we need to address those restrictions so people can move properly and reduce the risk of injury. And the thing is, with people with low back issues, usually they're not moving properly to begin with. And that's how an injury will develop over time. When you look at things from a chronic perspective, then the injury develops and then they realize maybe they're not moving properly or they're not sure how to address these movement restrictions that they have. So that's just my little note that I wanted to share with you guys. Two things to look out for: the lumbar spine, what's the lumbar spine telling you? Also, what is the hips telling you? How is an individual moving through the hips, and how is that relating to the lumbar spine? Are they compensating in some sort of manner? by doing that and looking at those things, you can get a good idea of how to address things. In some populations, you'll be able to get kind of almost an idea. For example, like I mentioned, hockey players, you're almost always likely going to see some hip stiffness or hip restrictions in hockey players just as a result of them always skating and being in that skating stride and being on the ice all the time. But this could apply to other populations as well when you look really into them and start working with those types of athletes or even just individuals perhaps. So that's just a little note I wanted to make. Hopefully this maybe explains things to you guys and some areas to kind of look for in terms of improving. And if you have any questions about maybe hip mobility, core stability, please be sure to leave a comment below and I'll be happy to get back to you. Hey guys, all the best and have a successful and productive day. Take care.